think it never makes sense. This will be a very short speaker because I think we have several leads lined up this week. Deliver privilege to the privilege hour during this consultation with the speaker. I would just like to congratulate the two gentlemen from Cebu and Paranaque for that very, very exciting discussion on that issue. I would just like to follow up, Mr. Speaker. The issue on defining the territorial lines of the country. It was mentioned that there was a change in the definition from baselines to regional finance. Is that correct?
That is correct with respect to the Kalayaan Island group and the Faho de Masinlo or Scarborough Show. Originally, we treated them as base points so that base lines can be extended towards the mainland.
For this presentation, enlightenment, Mr. Speaker. What is the difference between baselines and regime of
Kailan? A baseline means that you have a point, a base point. Example, Kalayaan Islands group, we have several islands and fighters. If that is considered a base point, it will be similar to the, let's say, base point somewhere in Ilocos Norte, or Ilocos Sur, or even Eastern Samar. Meaning that from a base point of that body of water will be considered territorial sea and not not open sea, not the high sea.
How about the regime?
But in the regime of islands, it's like Hawaii. You know, Hawaii is like the regime of islands. But the body of water from Hawaii to the mainland of the United States is international water, basically. International water, but the island is part of the U.S. territory. Faho de Masinloc treated as a region of islands, and that is the condition in our baseline. So it would be treated as part of territory and we exercise sovereignty over the island. And it projects its own territorial sea and exclusive economic zone.
Does that mean, Mr. Speaker, that by changing the definition, we virtually surrender our claim over the practice? Or does that mean that it weakened our position over the islands, Mr. Speaker?
Well, not necessarily, because we still claim those features as our territory. However, we lost a substantial part of what we could have called territorial sea. Imagine, you're talking about the Scarborough Shoal. Scarborough Shoal, about the Masinlo, is about 180 nautical miles from the mainland, from Zambales. There's another base point somewhere in the coast of Zambales. It will go to Scarborough Shoal, and from there, another base line which we projected to another base point in the west coast of Luzon. That triangle should have been part of the territorial sea. You're talking of maybe a few hundred thousand square kilometers of territorial sea lost because of that amendment.
So you're saying, Mr. Speaker, that we have actually surrendered our claim when we change the definition from baselines to regional finance. Because you said that we lost a substantial amount of value because of the change.
Yes, definitely. And not only body water, talking of the living and non-living resources there, minerals, especially in the Malaya group, because if you project from using that as a base point and project it back to Palawan, you're talking of areas that are right now being looked at for oil exploration. And this even goes beyond our exclusive economic zone.
So,
because part of the Kalayan Island group, some of the islands are outside of 200 miles of nautical mile limit.
So, Mr. Speaker, we could no longer reclaim those areas because we actually surrendered them by virtue of the change in the definition.
The sea, yes, but not the islands.
In our claim, lads, before the United Nations, Mr. Speaker, did we include those we lost in our commitment claim, Mr. Speaker, or we already abandoned that claim, Mr. Speaker?
Well, I think our claim will have to conform with our existing laws. And of course, the last one is the baseline law. And the baseline law, as correctly mentioned by our distinguished colleague from Cebu, who was part of the group that crafted that, provided for those islands as the regime of islands.
So, Mr. Speaker, we surrendered a substantial amount of our territory because of pressures from the People's Republic of China.
That is my belief. In my heart, I believe that there was pressure. In fact, if you look at the articles that came out, most of the articles referred to that external pressure. And that external pressure was conveyed to us by this high-power delegation from the Department of Foreign Affairs. We met them in the Rules Committee room. I think Congressman Garcia was there, I was there. Congressman Cuenco, the chairman of the Committee on Foreign Affairs at that time, was there almost in tears. In fact, he even almost refused to stand here in order to re-sponsor this new version of the baseline bill.
So, Mr. Speaker, this chamber is a party to that surrender. Is that the correct observation, Mr. Speaker?
Well, not necessarily, because, you know, in the crafting of laws, we have to interact with the executive branch. They are resource persons. They are considered to be experts. They advise us on what is doable and what is undoable, and what will become mathematically complicated. And we yielded, we yielded to that advice from the Department of Foreign Affairs.
So, Mr. Speaker, now that we have launched that issue before the United Nations, do you think that the Chinese government will also exert more pressure for us to abandon that claim?
I doubt it. I don't think so. Definitely, I don't think so. This is a new government. And if you look at the pronouncements of the President does not appear to be beholden to projects from China in the same way that it was in the past. We were so beholden to China with respect to, for example, North Rail, communications, projects, $2 billion worth of projects every year, coming from their vast resources. I think that was the carrot. I don't think there was any stick, but that was the carrot that was being dangled by the Philippine government. And at that time, I think, looking at it now, we know how deeply we were intertwined with China's economic resources at that time, which they used as a lever against us.
So, Mr. Speaker, our claim before the United Nations is not only based on the law that we passed but also based on the one clause, is that correct?
Not only on one clause, it's based on history. It's based on the fact that China did not have any overt occupation of those areas as even before the 1946 declaration. They did not have any occupation. The only time that the Chinese actually came in this part of the world in a hostile manner with the intent of occupying was during the time of Lima Hong. This was in 1580 or something, when Lima Hong came here. He landed in one of our barrios in Maranjaki, but they were repulsed by the people of Maranjaki at that time. And then he went to Pangasinan and settled in the place of our colleague from Higayen. But that was the only time. Before that, they had no history. In fact, some of the names that they gave to some of the features in the South China Sea were simply direct translations of English names, which shows you that these are not original Chinese terms, but translations already of English terms because of European explorers that went there. And they showed already a map made by an expert on maps earlier 1670, which shows that the Scarborough Shoal at that time, it was called another name, was considered part of it.